Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. My name is David Maeda, and I serve as the chair for the Council on Asian Pacific Minnesotans. The council is an executive branch, nonpartisan state agency charged with advising, advocating, and building connections on behalf of over 300,000 Minnesotans descended from more than 40 Asian and Pacific Islander nations. Our role within state government uniquely positions us to convene a geographically and ethnically diverse Asian and Pacific Islander Complete Count Committee. To this end, we have invited more than 70 Asian and Pacific Islander community leaders and organizations from across the state of Minnesota to participate as committee members. Our goals for the API Complete Count Committee include increasing the API response rate to the mailed instruction cards, creating trusted spaces for community members to ask questions, utilizing existing community knowledge, expertise, influence of committee members to create a targeted census awareness campaign, implementing a culturally responsive statewide information and outreach effort, and reporting on progress of each of the outreach efforts in different communities and adapting strategies based on what we have learned. In order to meet these goals, the API Complete Count Committee will develop and implement culturally appropriate strategies to reach hard-to-count residents and serve as a conduit to build and maintain trust among stakeholders with the U.S. Census Bureau, the Minnesota Department of Administration, as well as other state and local government entities. Our hope is that individual communities will generate their own community-specific coalitions and complete count committees and to act upon the Asian Pacific Islander Complete Count Committee developed strategies. To speak more about the need for the API Complete Count Committee in Minnesota and to provide updates on current census efforts, we have invited the following speakers today. We have Sam Fettig, Minnesota Partnership Lead with the U.S. Census Bureau, Andrew Verdon from the State Demographer's Office, Zhang Paul Lee, the Program Manager for Policy and Special Projects, Minnesota Council on Foundations, Bao Vang, the President and CEO of the Hmong American Partnership, Alan Malixi, a community leader with the PHIL Minnesota Association, Itao Ku, the Co-Executive Director from the Karen Organization of Minnesota, Famati Waini, a small business owner from our Samoan community, Ku Lor, a community leader from southwestern Minnesota, and Jocelyn Riamundo, the president and CEO of the Rochester Home Infusion. Following our speakers, I will invite Anjali Cameron, our research director and lead staff on the 2020 census, to address media questions.
My name is Sam Fettig, Minnesota Partnership Team Lead with the United States Census Bureau. On behalf of Ms. Marilyn A. Sanders, director of our Chicago region, I want to thank you for the opportunity to join you this morning for this exciting announcement. The census is our chance every 10 years to count everyone who lives in Minnesota and across the United States. The Census Bureau goes to extraordinary lengths to make sure that everyone is counted once, only once, and in the right place. It's important to get a complete and accurate count of everyone living in Minnesota for the 2020 census because census data determines how more than $675 billion in federal funding is distributed every year for things like schools, roads, water infrastructure, healthcare, and other services in our communities. The 2020 census count will also be used to determine political representation in Congress and to draw the lines for elections at the state, county, and city levels. A complete and accurate census count also paints a picture of the changing population of Minnesota and of our communities. The information informs decisions by businesses, nonprofits, and lawmakers about where to expand services to best serve our state. Marketing, outreach, and partnership efforts for the 2020 census are the most robust in census history, but we can't do it alone. Our local partners are vital in helping us to reach everyone, especially among those groups which have been historically hard to count. Some of the groups we know can be hard to count based on past census efforts include immigrants and refugees, those with language constraints, children under 5 years old, veterans, renters, and people living in poverty, among others. One of the best ways to close this gap and ensure a complete and accurate count of everyone living in Minnesota is through a complete count committee, like the Asian and Pacific Islander Complete Count Committee being formed here today. Our census partnership and recruiting staff work closely with these local leaders to encourage 2020 census participation, serving as trusted voices in their communities to spread the word that the census is safe, easy, and important. Complete Count committees also partner in efforts to recruit census takers for the 2020 census. Hiring local census takers who live in and know the communities they will be working in helps to build trust and encourage participation for a complete and accurate census count. These temporary jobs, available at 2020census.gov/jobs, offer flexible hours and good pay, going door to door in your community to remind your neighbors about the importance of completing the census questionnaire. The census is the largest peacetime mobilization in our country's history. It's a massive undertaking, but we are well prepared to achieve a complete and accurate count with the help of local trusted voices like those on the Asian and Pacific Islander Complete Count Committee. I want to thank everyone here today for your commitment to this crucial effort and look forward to our continued partnership to ensure a complete and accurate count in Minnesota.
Thank you and good morning. My name is Andrew Verdon. I'm the Director of Census Operations and Engagement for the State of Minnesota. I bring regards from Susan Brower, the State Demographer, who's not able to be here this morning. I want to extend a special congratulations to this committee for its formation. The work that you're doing is very, very important, not only to the state of Minnesota, but also to each of our communities that we belong to. In 2020, it is estimated that some 17.7% of the state of Minnesota, or 965,000 Minnesotans, will not self-respond to their census form without additional follow-up, which is why a complete count committee like this is so important in order to make sure that folks are hearing from trusted voices about the importance of participating in the census, and that when the actual enumeration is done, that it's done by people from the communities themselves with linguistic and cultural competencies. In 2010, Minnesota got the 435th seat of 435 seats in Congress, and the margin by which we held our 8th congressional seat was a mere 8,739 people. That means literally every person counts. And all the people around this table and the organizations and communities they represent are that difference that Minnesota is going to need in order to make sure that we count all of Minnesotans. As Sam mentioned, there are some categories of people who are more likely to be missed or who are historically undercounted. Renters, for example, 1.3 million renters in the state of Minnesota. Renter households are more likely to contain historically undercounted individuals, such as young adults, people who are highly mobile, immigrants, people of color, and people in rental housing are more likely to live in multi-unit buildings, which are even more difficult for census enumerators to access. 45% of foreign-born people in Minnesota live in renter households. 32% of Asian Minnesotans live in renter households. 40% of young adults age 18 to 24 live in renter households. And 30% of children under 5 live in renter households. So this is extremely important, the work that you're doing here. And I want to commend this group for its formation and for their help in making sure that all Minnesotans count so that we all count, we all matter. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Xiong Pao Li, or XP for short. I'm Program Manager for Policy and Special Projects with the Minnesota Council on Foundations. Pretty much, I'm the census coordinator. And for the past 5 to 6 years, we've been organizing with our partners, the State Demographer's Office, League of Women Voters, Common Cause Minnesota, MAX 2020, which is the Minnesota for Minnesotans for the American Community Survey, to get to this point right here. Because right now is mobilization time to get everybody ready to self-respond for the 2020 census in March of next year. To that end, we have created the Minnesota Census Mobilization Partnership. And our partnership is focused on reaching out and engaging historically undercounted communities all across the state. And we have 5 hubs to be able to do that, concentrating in CCCs, nonprofits, tribal, our census campaign, which is a relational organizing campaign and a hub focusing on greater and rural Minnesota. And this new Minnesota API CCC, led by the Council on Asian Pacific Minnesotans and the work that Anjali has been doing to get this going, is gonna be pivotal as a wraparound service to be able to spread the message of preparation, education, and participation in the 2020 census into all the nooks and crannies of Minnesota. Because we have to make sure that this is our census. Our recent work last year, engaging with communities, historically undercounted communities, tells us that they don't know enough, but they want to. They don't understand enough, but they want to. So it's on us, it really is, to be able to get out there, take the message to them, and help them understand how they can empower themselves and their communities through participating in the census. So I'm very happy that this is happening. This is a really great occasion, and look forward to working with this new Complete Count Committee to be able to make sure that this is our census and that we count here in Minnesota. Thank you guys very much.
Good morning, my name is Bao Wang, and I'm the present CEO of the Hmong American Partnership. We are the largest refugee immigrant agent-led organization in the state of Minnesota, where we served over 20,000 clients on an annual basis. And I just wanted to thank the council for establishing this Complete Count Committee. It's long overdue. We are also very fortunate to be partnering with the council during the 2010 census, in which HAP served as the chair of the Complete Count Committee. And you know, to that end, we're able to help the state of Minnesota achieve a very high Asian complete count. I just wanted to say that the census 2010 is once in a every 10-year opportunity, and that we all have a collective role and responsibility in ensuring that there are multiple strategies, multiple people doing this work together. I think that when I think about our role as a community-based organization is that the census serves three very important purposes. Number one, obviously, is the dollar that flows through the federal government to the state and to the local, where over $70 billion are being allocated. I think the other important piece is really ensuring that we also play a role in protecting the congressional seats, in exercising a voting power and a voting voice, and census is just one of them. And the third piece is that the census produced data that is going to be used for the next 10 years. It's our narrative. It's the data businesses use. It's data government elected officials or various entities use. And it's an opportunity for us to ensure that we achieve a very high accurate count. To that end, I just wanted to also remind all of us that there are some real challenges facing us and barriers that hinders our ability to achieve an accurate count. In the state of Minnesota and along with the rest of the country is that we know that underrepresented communities and communities of color are to be double between now and the year 2035. That means that the work is more challenging than ever. And having the opportunity and the privilege of serving in the 2010 census, I know that the work we do is not alone. We can't do our work in isolation. We need resources. We need to partner with the Census Bureau in a way that makes sense. Having a Census Bureau agent at the door does not get us the accurate count, but partnering with community-based organization or people from the community, churches, and other groups where there's trusted, you know, partnership, where that there's that relationship is going to achieve in the accuracy of the census count. Also, our community is facing, I think for the first time, heightened level of fears, and also a language barrier, and the list goes on and on. And I think that all of you guys would agree that if we don't do our job correctly in ensuring that there is an accurate count for Census 20, that the state is gonna, you know, lose out not only on a lot of money, which probably translates to about approximately $2,000 per person of dollars that could be lost for each person that we're able to count. And so my organization and I are fully committed, you know, to do this work alongside all of you guys. I think that the Asian's complete count is a urgency call for all of us to come together to find solutions, to find different strategies that we're going to work together in a different way to ensure that we minimize the fears, we minimize any language barrier, that we use our relationship in creating own strategies that work for our individual community so that we can make sure that our narrative for the next for the next 10 years reflects the accurate count of our community. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Alan Malixi, and I'm part of the Filipino American community here in Minnesota. Specifically, I'm part of the Film Minnesotan Association. I'd like to thank the council for giving us the opportunity to work with them on this 2020 census drive. The Film Minnesotan Association is one of 13 Filipino American organizations within Twin Cities. I sit on a small board of a cross-section of members from each of from those organizations, and together, over the past several months, we've been working on strategy to help the Filipino American community, not only in the Twin Cities, but outside of the Twin Cities, to engage itself in the 2020 census. You've heard several people up here, in fact, all of them, talk about the importance of this engagement, the allocation of resources, good governance, as Sia has spoken to me about, congressional districting, school districts. But also for us as Asian Americans, and not only just Filipino Americans, we talk about our civic pride. Voting is one of the most important things we do, but to be counted accurately is just as important for those resources, for that good governance. So what I'm encouraging not only our community to do, but other communities within the Asian Pacific community here in Minnesota, is to engage yourself. Connect with us as Filipinos, connect with us as Hmong, connect with us as Polynesian, Southeast Asian, and be partners with us so we can get this census drive going at its highest rate of engagement possible. If you are interested in connecting with us as a Filipino community, I have contact information not only for myself, but for other members of the Filipino organizations that I'm working with. So please don't hesitate to contact me right after this press conference, and I'll be glad to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Hello, and thank you very much for letting me speak with you today. My name is Etta Ku, and I am the co-executive director of the Korean Organization of Minnesota. The Korean Organization of Minnesota is the nonprofit organization led by Korean refugees who came to the United States fleeing civil war in Burma. The mission of the Korean Organization of Minnesota is to enhance the quality of life for all refugees from Burma in Minnesota. Last year, our staff served over 2,000 Korean Minnesota in employment, social, community health, youth development, and also working services. And currently there are over 15,000 Korean refugees from Burma living in Minnesota. The Korean have been under persecution, oppression in Burma for hundreds of years, with the tension reaching a high point after World War II. Due to decades of military conflicts and persecution, tens of thousands of Korean people have to relocate from Burma to Thailand and resettled to that third country as a refugee beginning in 2004. In Burma, the census was used by Burmese majority government as a way to identify, persecute, and discriminate against Korean people and also other minority ethnic groups in Burma. I remember hearing from my parents that the school I went to in Burma asked my parents to change all of our names in Burmese, because that way we can be counted as Burmese instead of Korean. And of course, my parents refused to do that. But there are still a lot of Korean people with Burmese name, and they are most likely to be counted as Burmese. Not only that, there are a lot of Korean people who are living in a conflict zone, in a war zone that doesn't have any documentation. They're not counted in a census system. As I said before, arriving of the Korean to the United States beginning in 2004, and the majority of Korean in Minnesota arrived in the last decade and have never completed their U.S. census. And because of the Civil War and a lot of Korean people have never got a chance to go to school, and the time spent in refugee camps, we have very few Korean people that know how to speak English or can read government documents. Some of them don't even know how to read their own language. Our Korean community is spread across Minnesota, including Marshall, Austin, Eberly, Wilmore, St. Cloud, and Worthington. We are new to Minnesota, and many people do not know that we are here. It's important that we are counted so that people know we are here and we are ready to embrace our new home in Minnesota. Thank you very much.
Good morning, my name is Famati Amuawaini, a small business owner and also a Samoan Polynesian community leader. I think this census drive 2020 is can be very important for our community, not only because we are such a small group, we're not even a formalized document yet in Minnesota. We made up about 1.1% of the population in Minnesota, so I think this will be a great outreach and it also engaging in within our own community, but also with our community within the council. So I very much appreciate and thank you to council for inviting our group. Besides, we are very small groups, the bigger groups here in communities. So I would like to hopefully work with the council and then within our own Polynesian community to, if we work together, engage in our community, form the counting committee so that we can count every Polynesian that resides in Minnesota. Everybody matters, every person counts. So I will really appreciate if our group to work with us on this counting committee census drive. Thank you.
Good morning, and I'd like to start off by saying thank you to the Council on Asian Pacific Minnesotans for providing me and the API communities of Greater Minnesota an outlet to share our voices. Thank you for your continued support, love, and advocacy for Asian Americans in this state. My name is Ku, and I come from a small community in the southwest corners of the state. I come where soybeans and corn stalks are vast, and downtowns make up of a couple of blocks, where visitors are asked to not blink while driving through, and trains are the barriers to getting to work on time. I'm a part of a larger community that is often forgotten in the midst of policy decisions and community advocacy. I am Hmong, and I represent the Hmong community in Southwest Minnesota. Hmong families in Southwest share the love of a quiet community and respect the landscapes of the region. Many families move to the area to find less competitive work and to raise a family away from the bustle of larger cities. Today, roughly 200 Hmong families make Southwest Minnesota their home and live mainly in three communities: Tracy, Walnut Grove, Martin, and Marshall. Our communities continue to contribute to the workforce by working hard and collectively with employers such as Schwann's, BH Electrics, and Toro. Children are provided with great caring schools and extracurricular activities to establish their education and to help to build them as the next generation of leaders. Rural Minnesota remains a great place to live. However, there are many obstacles that continue to challenge and impact the lives of the Hmong community. Although many have made Southwest Minnesota home for more than 20 years, there continues to be a lack of resources to educate and sustain the well-being of all families. Among all things, there is a great need for support in educating our young leaders, ones who have a great potential, but could use guidance to support and lead the community. In rural Minnesota, where we do have to fight to make ourselves heard, this is an essential piece to ensuring our success. As we know, the 2020 census is around the corner, and for many API communities, it still continues to be a struggle. The overall understanding of the process and lack of completion is what holds us all from reaching our fullest potential. That is why I am delighted today to hear that the Asian Pacific Islander Complete Count Committee is here, and that they will ensure that all APIs in Greater Minnesota will have a voice. We want to make sure that we are not forgotten in this process, and we want to hold accountable ourselves as well as our city, our counties, and our elected officials for making this count our count as well. Minnesota will always be our home where we will continue to thrive, live, work, and play. And thank you.
Good morning. My name is Jocelyn Raimundo, and I'm a CEO and president of Rochester Home Infusion. I represent Rochester, Minnesota. I'm Southeast Minnesota. I come here really with a perspective of a business owner as well as a community leader that is pretty, very much entrenched in the community of Rochester. I really want to thank everybody who's here with us because in many, many ways, these are the people who are truly part of the fabric of our population in Minnesota. This is why Census 2020 is really very important, not just to be counted. We want to be recognized. We want to be recognized as a growing population of the state of Minnesota that is key to the economic development as well as the economic diversity that is going on in our state. And many of you probably have heard that southern Minnesota, especially in Rochester, there is the Destination Medical Center. And the inception of the Destination Medical Center really is a strategy to make southern Minnesota and Rochester the global destination for health. With that said, what we don't really see are the people behind the drivers of Destination Medical Center. And every single one of us in southern Minnesota must be represented and must be counted as we contribute in growing the economy and providing economic diversity in southern Minnesota. As some of you may already be familiar, a lot of the Filipinos in southern Minnesota came to Rochester to work for the Mayo Clinic as they were recruited from the Philippines. And I'm very, very proud of my colleagues as they continue to provide leadership and provide guidance to the new generation Filipinos who are continuing to represent a very educated, very hardworking, incredibly productive population. This is why Census 2020 is even more important. Yes, it is a number, but most importantly, it is recognition. Recognition backed up by the number that we as a population, Asian Pacific Islander, they count, we matter, and that we should actively engage in this census because only with engagement, we can gain representation and recognition for the work that we do. Thank you so much.
Okay, so thank you again. My name is Anjali Mishra Cameron. I'm research director here at the Council on Asian Pacific Minnesotans, and I'm also the staff responsible for leading census initiatives, and I've been doing it for just about a year now. I want to take a moment to thank everybody who is here today. We, as you can see, our API community is incredibly diverse. Just from the speakers that you heard today, they've done a phenomenal job. They wear many hats, and they took time out of their busy schedules to address you today. I particularly want to thank our representatives from Greater Minnesota who had to get up quite early to drive here today. So we very much appreciate your presence.